I'm Talia Riccioni, Education Director at the Bateman Horne Center, here with volunteer emergency specialist Linda Milne, who will begin a series about emergency supplies and how they can be used to respond appropriately to disaster. Linda?
Thanks, Talia. Hi, everyone. I am very delighted to be with you today to share some emergency supply suggestions and offer some guidance on how to use them. If you would like a copy, instructions for getting that would be at the end of our video. So there's no need to take notes. Have you ever asked yourself this question? And you've asked it maybe more than once. Why prepare for events that may never happen? After all, preparing is costly in money, time, and takes attention from other important matters in our life. And I think that's a reasonable view, unless you were to direct that question to someone who has been injured in a disaster or suffered the loss of loved ones and property. They will tell you that being prepared and informed so you can respond appropriately is essential. I have an overall emergency strategy. It's approach preparation with response in mind. That is my take on the common phrase, begin with the end in sight, to avoid missteps and omissions. I see four response strategies that would be relevant for a long list of risks. Sheltering at home without utilities, evacuation by auto to leave the area, or on-foot evacuation. None of these responses is possible without preparation. And preparation requires supplies and some know-how. Under normal circumstances, I would begin talking with you about sheltering at home. But because of the pandemic disaster our entire planet is all too familiar with, home sheltering by choice or by mandate is something that we have all experienced. So I want you to imagine that home sheltering is complicated by an event where you live that impacts some or even all of your utilities. That could mean no flushing toilets or safe tap water, no electricity or natural gas for temperature control, cooking, refrigeration, computer and lighting. No access to your pharmacy or doctor. No television or desktop computer. No easy way to communicate. No garbage collection. It's kind of sobering, isn't it, for everyone involved? But it is especially so for those of us who are vulnerable because of health and age. I'd like to take you through various scenarios that you could be faced with. And I'm going to begin with sanitation. I'm not uncomfortable talking about bathroom matters, even the down and dirty details of it all. So I hope you aren't uncomfortable listening. If your municipal sewer system goes down, stop using your toilet. If you're prepared with a plan and supplies, you can set up an emergency bathroom. If not, you could risk a home health crisis. That setup requires the following steps. Dry the toilet bowl. Lift the lid and line the bowl with a heavy black plastic bag. Lower the seat to hold the bag liner in place. This will be your solid waste station. I call it, it's a poop station. Bring in a box with grips or a bucket with handles for carrying. Put a 5 or 6 gallon plastic bucket with a snap-on seat and lid in the bathroom for urine collection. A 2.5 gallon bucket works well for kids. Each time the toilet bowl is used, throw in a strong deodorizer and close the lid. When the bag has been used many times, but before it becomes too heavy or threatens to leak, put on a mask and gloves. Lift the bag carefully from the toilet bowl and place it in the carry box or bucket. At this point, just loosely but securely tie it off. Sanitize the toilet area and line the bowl with a new bag. Then move the used bag out to your collection or disposable location. In either case, a point furthest from your house. A collection point could be a galvanized garbage can with a tight-fitting lid, or better, a polyethylene drum for hazardous waste. And yes, our solid waste does qualify. Let the air out of the bag, tie it off very tightly, and place it in the container. Now secure the lid. A more permanent solution for solid waste involves creating a disposal point. You will need what's called a cat hole, about 3 feet plus deep and far from the house. A pole digger is needed, and hey, a person to dig it. You will need a bag of lime powder and newspapers. So here's the disposal process. You have your used bag. You bend down near the mouth of the hole. Carefully empty the contents to the bottom of the hole, followed by the bag itself. Then a layer of lime and newspaper. Finish with a shovelful or two of dirt and cover the opening with a paver or something heavy to prevent animal interference. Do not put used bags into regular garbage cans. Don't leave them on the street or in a vacant lot or bury too shallowly. All of that invites animals and insects to spread the threat of serious illness, even death. Read about the sanitation consequences in Haiti after that earthquake if you want some convincing. Urine is not toxic and does not need such careful collection and disposal. You can add a powder gel product to turn the liquid into a gelatinous substance for easier moving. Water weight is heavy, so empty regularly into the yard. Your garden is a perfect place as it will fertilize the soil. Be sure to turn the soil over a few times. Otherwise, spread it around as opposed to dumping it in a single place. And that's all about odor control. Now to change the subject to another essential emergency supply, and that is water. When you no longer have safe tap water, you have to rely upon being prepared with treatment chemicals like household bleach or purification tablets, or a source to boil the water, maybe a high quality gravity filtering system, or your own stored water. You can never have too much safe water stored because hydration is a lifeline. Some of you may know that after 3 days, our kidneys begin to fail. For longer term, store water in 55-gallon or larger water barrels. Fill with treated municipal water, but you must use a special white hose obtained from a big box, hardware, or RV store. Do not use your garden hose. 5-gallon containers are practical. Rain barrels are a dependable source of some water, but you would need layers of cheesecloth to filter small debris, and then a high quality gravity filter, chemical treatment, or boiling. In my opinion, the easiest prepare solution is to buy cases and cases of purified water. That also has the benefit of your water being more portable. Now to food. While we can go without for days, even weeks, it's very uncomfortable to be hungry. Storing food will avoid that. You need calories to think clearly and to handle your own emotions. Buying in bulk is the least expensive way to store food. and can meet long-term needs. Freeze-dried and dehydrated meals can be bought and forgot for 25 years or used as regular meals. Most people prepare by simply storing ample supplies of family favorite canned and packaged food and keeping it all or part of it in the coolest location in your home. Singles and couples should include some food in meal-sized portions. In emergency circumstances, you will want plenty of snacks and treats, that I can assure you, and many of them store well. Rotate your stored canned and packaged food into regular use, but if you do that, you've got to be sure to replace it. Nut milks or dry powdered milk substitute well for dairy. Evaporated milk added to non-fat dry milk really improves the taste. If a sustained power loss is part of your emergency, saving refrigerated foods becomes urgent after 4 hours. Frozen meats, fish, and other items start perishing at about 48 hours. You will need emergency supplies in order to take action. Keep 10 to 20 pound bags of ice or pre-frozen packs, homemade frozen water bags and bottles. You want them in your freezers in empty spaces. It's efficient use of energy and it is essential for use in power outages. Have insulated coolers large enough to hold ice and packs and the food you want to save. In a prolonged outage, ice will eventually melt. I say grill the food up and invite the neighbors. Create as little garbage as possible. It may not be collected as usual. So break down boxes to conserve space in your garbage cans. Of course, we know a generator can save the day, but it has major drawbacks of cost, fuel, fumes, and noise. I hope this video has been helpful. If you would like a copy of our emergency supply list, drop me a note in my iCloud email address. We will continue this sequence, preparing to respond with age and health limitations, with a few more videos. There is a lot of shopping information and how-to in these presentations. It is important to ask others to help or even to manage the emergency prepare process. Please, please remember, pace your own efforts. Prioritize how you approach preparation. As always, if you have questions or comments, they're very welcome. I will respond to them. Thanks for watching.